Good afternoon. Very welcome to this Thursday afternoon with me and my very, very good friend, Louise Triance. Louise should be appearing on screen any moment now, as if by magic. And today we are here to talk about creating killer or kick-ass, or both killer and kick-ass, live stream events. Louise, how the devil are you? And where are you? I need to see your camera.
I think you might have been turning my camera on at the same time I was, which meant that I was turning my... I've done that before.
Lesson number one.
Decide who's in control, which is quite challenging when you both want to be in control.
Yeah, we're both, what is it, A personalities?
Yeah, that's it. But for the purpose of
this... No, it's my show.
Well, my name's gone first on the slides. So, but I'm going to ask you a question. What are we talking about today?
We are talking about kick-ass events, what to do to create events that are memorable, that people want to come to beforehand and are glad to have attended afterwards. And in order of what we have listed on screen, there are five key elements to creating amazing events that that are going to do just that. So as you can see on screen, planning, format, promotion, engagement, and content. Now that sounds simple, but what we're going to do is get into some of the nuts and bolts of those and what exactly that means when you're preparing to run your own events.
And we couldn't entirely agree there were five, so I did the slides, and there's definitely more than five key elements. So before we get started, Stephen, we ought to just explain who we are. So yes. I've been running events in person and online for a very, very long time. I run UK Recruiter, so you set up networking events years and years ago. Now I do online events. My camera's all fuzzy because I haven't sorted out my autofocus, which is one of the key tips. Mm-hmm. There we go. Am I still fuzzy, Stephen?
Really important. No, you're perfectly fine. No, you're fine. It'll cool. Go fuzzy in a minute again.
And I also work with Crowdcast. So I also work with Stephen on going live events.
Yep. So equally, I've been in the same sector, recruitment sector, for decades and decades. Let's not go into that. But inadvertently in all that time, organizing in-person events and, of course, subsequently online events for the past 10 years. So between us, we have hosted and run either for ourselves or for other people, maybe 1,000 events altogether. Certainly lots over the years. And in the past year in particular, whilst we've been doing video events for the past 10 years, in the past year in particular, it stepped up for obvious reasons, given the pandemic that we're all living through. And what it means is that lots of companies, lots of organizations and individuals are looking for ways in which they can get the message out there and be more visible than they might otherwise be by using platforms like Crowdcast or Zoom or many others out there to get themselves across in a more three-dimensional way and, of course, share their brand, what thinking about. And hopefully that'll lead to business or engagement or marketing in accordance with their plans.
Right, planning. You've just said the first word. So if I look at my slides, now the problem I've got is I've got two screens and I've got a very, very tiny mouse and I'm using my wrong hand. So am I going to be able to move on to my next slide is the question. Let's have a go. If I can't, we'll have to just... Okay, Stephen, that's it. The planning.
Yes.
So this is the why of doing an event. Now, I kind of think it's sort of obvious, but I've spoken to a number of people who've been told they should be running events, either online or in person, online or in face-to-face. And we're talking about online events here. That's kind of the area we're considering in this regard. And I think that for online events, it's really easy for someone to say, oh, you ought to be doing podcasts, or you ought to be showing your expertise, or we did this conference in person in 2019, let's do it online this year. And then you just kind of throw yourself into it. And you and I have both had to work with people who've missed this stage out.
Yeah, you really have to question why you're doing it. And the thing is that sometimes when you go through the process, you might realize, actually, I shouldn't have an online video event. I should do something else instead. There are lots of ways in which you can be getting your message out there. And a video event is a great way to do it, but in some circumstances is not the correct answer. And also years ago when everyone started blogging and people said, oh, you have to have a blog. Well, yes, you have to have a blog if you can write well, if you can get good content out regularly and it's up to a certain standard. If your blog's going to show you in a poor light, then don't do it. And equally, with anything out on online, don't do it unless you can make sure that it's to a standard that you're going to be happy with and your audience will be happy with as well. So you have to represent yourself well. We're all vain to a certain extent. And we all want to look good on camera, or we all want to sound good on camera. We all want to sound as if we know what we're talking about and that this has been thought through. We've not just run into the room, flipped on the camera, and started talking away, because that's not going to get you anywhere. So in terms of planning, the why am I organizing this event? Why do I want to do it? What's my purpose? What's the audience that I want to attract to come and see this event? Why would they be interested in an event from me? What do I have to share? So the planning is at the core of your thinking about an event in advance. And if you can't tick those boxes, then don't go any further. Don't have an event just for the sake of it.
No, and the point about an engaging topic as well is that you might think, oh yeah, we can do this, we've done it in person, or I like talking about this thing, but does anybody else care about it? Is this the right forum to do that? Because you're an expert in something doesn't mean that it's actually an engaging topic. And knowing who your audience is and thinking about what they're going to want to hear about is exactly the same as writing a blog. It's a really good analogy, is that you need to think about the frequency that you're going to do this. And then we'll talk about this a bit more later. But, you know, is it going to be a one-off? Is it going to be a series? But what is the pull going to be? How am I going to get my targeted audience to come to my event? What's the logistics part of this, Stephen?
Well, the logistics part of this is it doable? If you have a date that you want to set for your event, say it was this time next month or, you know, tomorrow, then when you're planning ahead for something, you might realize I can manage all of this. This is totally doable. Either me, myself, or I can involve other people, or I can get guests. I can put all these things together, the elements that will make it work. Or I want to do the event tomorrow and I realize actually that's just not doable. So the logistics are really important there in terms of do you have all the things that you put together on your list of, you know, to do to make this event work. And sometimes you realize actually I don't have enough time, or I don't have the guests that I would want, or I haven't prepared a presentation or a talk, or you know, the content that I would want to share. So that will have an effect on when your date's going to be, whether you'll be ready in time. If you were having an event that was a precursor to something else, then can you squeeze it in before that thing, or is there not enough time to do it?
And one of the great things about online events is that if you do have to change dates and have to move logistics around, it's a little bit easier to do that. You just, you know, you've already got an audience who have already engaged with you. Now, if it's a full day conference, it's slightly different than a webinar. But if you've committed to doing webinars every Thursday at 3 and then you can't do one at 3 on a Thursday, it's a lot easier to move that than if it was an in-person event.
Between you and I, and I won't be naming names because that's not the nice thing to do, but I know of lots of events in the past year, certainly this year, that are big showcase events where they've got lots of speakers, they've got lots of content and so on, but they just don't have the audience. And audiences are really particular these days. Now, if you have an in-person event where people are flying from one end of the country to the other to come to your event, then there are pros and cons with that, because people have to, you know, book flights, book hotels, and make a commitment. When they're coming to an online event, then the commitment level required is pretty low. They could decide, you know, 5 minutes beforehand, actually, I don't have time to go and watch that, and they won't turn up to your event. So they're not locked in the way they were before. And also, if you change the day and the date of it, then that might make it impossible for someone to watch. So the tie-in with your intended audience is really important. If you don't do it ahead of time, if you don't do it all the way through the process, then your live numbers on the day might be pretty modest. And I've been involved in some events where the numbers have been crackers through the roof, and I'm trying to work out what did they do that made this work, and others where they seem to have ticked all the boxes, but the numbers were, you know, kind of embarrassing.
Yeah, Yeah. Although actually sometimes with online events it's less obvious. But okay, we're going to come to pleasing all your parties later. So the next part of this is the format of this, the how, the where. And obviously for me, one of the first things I think about is what platform is this going to be on? Because that's, you know, I love Crowdcast, but there are other platforms out there. Have I got these in the right order, or is it irrelevant the order in which we look at them in?
Well, each of these elements overlaps with the other. So yeah, when you're talking about format, your platform is vital to the type of format that you're going to have. So people will in the last year have used Zoom lots and lots, and there are a couple of other direct competitors to Zoom, but they're the one that everyone knows. So you know, Zoom, Teams, and a variety of others, Google Hangouts, not or Google Meets as it would be now. But if you want to have up to 49 people on screen, then you can do that in a checkerboard grid of people on Zoom. And on Crowdcast has a maximum of 6 slots on screen, and there are a huge number of pros for Crowdcast, but one of the things that you just can't do is go beyond the 6 people on screen. So the platform can be really important. If you're having a full day conference, then you might choose one of the specifically built platforms for
Yeah,
that,
like
like
swap card.
Hopin, Swapcard, Remo.
Yeah.
There's a number of them out there. And Hopin, I think, is now valued at billions.
We're not talking
And
about
was only
hopping on this show.
Okay, but my point here is that some platforms have seemingly come out of nowhere and accelerated through the roof.
Yeah.
And you can shop around, you can have a play on all of them, I think, to work out what's best for you. But most of what you would want to do can certainly be done on a Crowdcast or on Zoom, and the other ones I would investigate if you have that bigger event with lots of things going on throughout a day.
Cool. And then when you're making a decision about the platform you're going to use, one of the things you just touched on was the number of people who you're going to want to have on screen with you. Now, I think probably you're going to know whether it's going to be just you talking to camera about your passion, or whether it's going to be you interviewing somebody or having a panel. And then, you know, if it's a webinar, it might be a slightly different format. You're going to want to share slides. If it's a conference, are you going to have a ton of sessions all happening at the same time? If that's the case, then the platform needs to be able to support that. I mentioned swap card. You know, you can have booths on platforms like that, Big Marker, Gold. There's platforms to allow you to have that conference feel. I'm going to say something I think is probably widely known but slightly contentious, which is it's difficult to do networking at an online event. So if that's going to form a really big part of what you're doing, think incredibly carefully about the platform you're going to use.
The perfect solution to networking has yet to be found, and I've seen some that kind of, you know, are pointing in that direction. You think, oh, that's interesting. If enough people use this, then that would be that could really catch on. But of course, with any new platform, with any new toy or gadget or tool, you know, things that you're asking people to do, if they've not done it before and they're working it out at the time, then you might find that you have an event, you have an amazing platform for people to network on, and they just can't get to grips with it. It's not obvious, it's not easy, it's not intuitive, and you're asking them to do some of the work, which is kind of tricky to do. We all know how to walk into a conference center and, you know, mingle or not mingle. Some people are good at it, some people avoid it like the plague. But in an online scenario, there's a whole different set of, I suppose, well, etiquette in what you do and how you do it, and people are kind of still learning. So whenever you have a new way of asking people to network or allowing people to network, then their acceptance, their adoption of that is vital, because if they don't, then it can seem as if no one is using it.
And that's about communication with your audience. So that's something I think that we talk about a bit later. But you know, if you're going to be doing something on a platform people aren't familiar with, making certain that you're letting your audience know how to utilize it best. So one of the things I've done for an event you and I were involved in was an attendee guide. So showing people this is what it's going to look like when you register, this is how you're going to reaccess the platform, that type of information. If you're going to use a channel like Discord, which actually we both went to an event on Discord that was organized well over a year ago, all the gamers knew how to use it. and the majority of the rest of the people had never been on there. So don't make assumptions about, you know, someone's familiarity in moving between rooms. Let them know if their cameras are going to need to be on or not. So with the Zoom thing, you know, you join a Zoom call. Am I going to be on camera as an audience member or not?
Yeah.
You need to prepare people for that, don't you?
Yeah. So if they know what to expect in advance, if you can communicate in a precise but affable way in advance, then they know to plan ahead, you know, to be on camera. If you're going to ask them up and they're not prepared, then they'll be totally flustered. And if they're going to be part of the event.
No, I'm going to ask you about live or pre-recorded, but I just thought something really important there, which is in an in-person event, you think about accessibility. Do the same for your online event. So things like Google Chrome have the captions that you can switch on as an attendee. So let your attendee know that, attendees know that. If you're going to have a transcript available afterwards, make sure they know that. If you've got somebody who needs to use a screen reader and your technology supports that, make sure they know those things. Because you would in an in-person event, you wouldn't just let, you know, not check what other needs people have. Do the same with online. It's your responsibility as the host to do that.
You could also consider in advance. A lot of events, they say, we'll give out the slides afterwards. Well, actually, there's no harm in giving out slides in advance. And it might just be that it's got the speaker's notes as opposed to, you know, because slides often don't tell you much other than, you know, there's a nice big picture on there. But the speaker's notes will have the details of what's going to be spoken about. And if someone has that, then it's a great accompanying thing to have alongside what's been spoken about on screen. And you say accessibility, having the Google feature, which allows for text subtitles to be appearing, is great. There's other things that you can do. For example, people don't know some of the things you can do on Chrome, such as, you know, zooming in, zooming out for text that's unreadable, that sort of thing. They may know that already if they already have if their sight's impaired in some way, or if their hearing's not fantastic, then they may already be, pardon the pun, tuned into that sort of thing. But you can give them that advice in advance of an event to make sure that they're catered for.
Okay, talk to me about live or pre-recorded, because I know we've both got our opinions on that.
So I've been doing a bit of both in a particular event, one of which I did at the weekend on Sunday night for a non-profit in the States. And in the course of that event, it was on Crowdcast, so they had multi-sessions going on. And some of the sessions, well, the first session was live. It was, as we are now, it was the host on screen live. But the next session was actually playing three separate video clips, which in total came to about an hour long. And they were movie quality. So what you wanted was the stereo audio. If you're in browser like us, then the audio is mixed down to mono, which is fine for speech. But if you've got music playing, that's not so clever. And there was a lot of music and performance in these videos. So what we did was we streamed those through RTMP to Crowdcast, and that was pre-recorded content. So mixing pre-recorded with live sessions like this, it's more straightforward to do than you think, but if you're doing one or the other, then that's an absolute breeze. Mixing them, you just need to plan in advance to make sure that happens. But when you use pre-recorded content and stream it through RTMP, you can get a TV quality style content going out. So as you say, if it was a movie or a screener or a performance, then that's what your audience is looking for. Midjour, his content is not pre-recorded, but he does RTMP live, and that means that the very best quality comes through to the people who are watching his shows on Crowdcast.
Because that's what you're thinking about here. You're thinking about what's going to be the best experience for the end user, the audience, but also for your speakers. I mean, I prefer to see these type of things live. And I think it's really obvious when it is live, you know, you see the interaction with each other. If I was pre-recording this, I wouldn't be drinking my coffee. I'm always drinking my coffee when I'm live. There's not enough hours in the day not to drink my coffee. So I like that kind of the kind of obviousness of a live performance. But like, you know, a movie screening, you want that pre-recorded, you want that really high quality.
Well, interactivity with your attendees, so people chatting in the chat bar, then having that on a busy event is great to be able to do. Being able to respond to that, or questions that are being asked, or responses to a poll that you've set, all those kind of things are great.
I've moved on to the next slide. Promotion. Mm-hmm. So this is about getting bums on seats. Normally, that's quite a key factor for people running events. So normally, they do want an audience there. Sometimes, maybe your purpose isn't that. Maybe there are other reasons why you might run an event. So it might be because mm-hmm. you want to interview some people specifically to flatter them. Maybe you're providing content which is going to form part of some other bigger picture, and the actual numbers live isn't that important. Yeah. But broadly yeah. speaking, you're looking to get decent numbers there. Yeah. And I'm not going to read through this, but you know what you're thinking about is who are my audience engaging with? Let's start with them if they're the right audience. Mm-hmm. And how am I going to get in front of them? Creating messaging out to that audience and using social media. If I quickly go through this, and then you can add in, Stephen. Using social media as part of that, especially using your speaker networks. So I think it's absolute madness to have somebody presenting in your event and not ask them to partake in the promotion of that. They'll be flattered that they're talking, hopefully, and they are obviously somebody who's got a network or knowledge in your space. Utilize that. Don't underestimate the value of media partnerships. So mm-hmm. working with other people who also share your audience. And then paid for promotion, you know, Facebook yeah. advertising, Google, things like that. What do you mm-hmm. want to add to that?
So if your event is a free event, then that would be quite different from a paid event. So if you're for a paid event, you have to expect that you're giving something that's worthwhile for people to pay to be there. And in doing so, your promotion will be of a slightly different nature to a free event. But yeah, absolutely. Whoever is involved in your event, have them be part of the promotion of that, because that's what people are coming to see. After all, the people who are the hosts are normally not the attraction. If you've got great speakers, if you've got great performers, if you've got content being on screen that's unique, then the people involved in that should be at the forefront of your promotion. Yes, you absolutely have to get the details of your event out well in advance. I'll give you for example. So when I run my awards event each year, it's the Notice, the event itself is in November. We sell some tickets. There's a flurry of tickets are sold 3 months in advance, and then there's another flurry of tickets in the fortnight before. And this is a paid for event, but in the gap in between, the ticket sales are kind of bitty. So when people hear about the event in the first place, they think, oh, I better book my ticket, get that reserved. And just before the event, they realize, oh, I absolutely have to be there. Yep. So the buying or the booking patterns of people who are likely to be coming to your event is good to be aware of that. And if you're doing an event on a regular basis, then you'll learn, the nature of your own audience. But you also find out what platforms they would respond best on. If you are sending out emails or messages on social media platforms, or even by post, then ways in which you can engage with people. Some events that we've seen recently, the audience is engaged with by sending out content to them, bottle of beer, information that's going to be relevant to the content in the show itself. And all of these are ways in which you can connect with and lock people into attending the event.
That locking people in, I think, is something which is, if you can find a way to do that, people commit to going to an event online mm-hmm. specifically, and then closer to the time, they're like, this is bound to be pre-recorded. So what additional value can you give somebody who turns up live, I think, is really important. So the ability to ask a question to the person on screen, to engage directly with the person on screen when they want to, maybe some sort of giveaway. I was at an event, a Slack event, talking about using that channel, and they were giving away goodie bags, and you had to be there at the end to get the goodie bag. Well, that's just the same as you were doing an in-person event. I like the fact they were doing that. But also, like you said, sending out stuff ahead of time so that they can they can utilize that stuff alongside the event. Maybe they've got the slides, maybe they've got the notepad and the pen and the headphones. Mm. They're going to feel more part of it, aren't they?
Well, you're doing an event soon, a whiskey tasting event, and people will have, some sort of whiskey sent out to them so they can be tasting the whiskey at the same time as the event is on. So that sort of thing. One thing I've been thinking a lot about recently is hybrid events, where we're going to get back to in-person events will be happening, But there's a certain proportion of people who will never go back to events. Mm-hmm. It might be a small proportion who it's never, but there's another proportion who are still wary, and their employers might say, you're not going to events, not until next year or whenever. So in order to cater for those people, and bear in mind that in online events, you can have people anywhere in the world attending your online event, but an in-person event, they have to physically get there. So there used to be the conundrum with football years ago, where do we televise a game between Man United and Chelsea? If we televise it, then not so many people will buy tickets for the game itself, and we want more people at the game. Now, they thought long and hard about the pros and cons of, you know, whether one would work or not. But on TV, when you're watching a game, you get a far different experience to you would when you're at the game. At the game, there's more excitement. You're in amongst a crowd of 50,000 people and you had to be there. But you might not see the goals and you certainly don't see any replays. And there are some things you don't get there that you would get in the you know, on TV. And it's the same with online events or hybrid events. So if there was a hybrid event with various speakers speaking and exhibitors showing the wares and so on, being there, you would need to make, you would want to make an incentive for people to be there at the event and experience something in person. But conversely, online, give them something that they wouldn't get at the event. And that might be behind the scenes, you know, chats with speakers before or after they're about to go on, or, you know, more detailed demos with exhibitors that show you their products in much more detail. So there are pros and cons of both. And I think it's really important as we come to the time now, and certainly in the next few months, to be thinking about the two different aspects and how they can work together.
No, we ought to do a show about that specifically. Okie dokie. So next one, this is the fourth one. Is this really the fourth one? I've lost my notes. Format. No, I've gone wrong. Gone the wrong way. That's what I've gone wrong. I knew it didn't make any sense. Okay, so I snuck this one in. So we're not going to talk about this in much detail because the next one is actually engagement, which was the real one that you said. But I just really quickly wanted to say that unless you prepare your speakers properly, then you are going to come up against troubles. So I like to ensure that my speaker knows exactly what to expect. So I give them a really clear brief, a briefing around what I'm going to give them, and I'm going to ask them what they're going to give me, and we're going to agree to it. So this is around, the talk's going to be this long, you're going to give me your slides by this date, I'm going to put you in front of this audience on this platform. If they're producing a slide deck and you don't give them any support with it, don't be too surprised when it's Comic Sans and hideous inappropriate memes. So think about that. If it's online, obviously tech checks. If it's in person, venue checks. And then one of the things I think we probably have to say this less now, but with an online event, you're not able to walk the stage. You need to help these people to get the energy, the engagement. You need to say to them about, I mean, I adamantly refuse to look at the camera lens. Stephen is probably cursing me now. I'm not looking at the camera lens because I think it's freaky to do that. But actually getting them to look at the stage, I don't like that. It's unnerving me. Getting them to actually engage with the audience is really important. And telling them what the contingency plan is so that if there's a problem, they're not there sitting there sobbing. They know what you're going to do about it. So
it's really important to appreciate the perspective of anyone involved in your event, whether it's a speaker who's going to be speaking solo, or people who are on a panel, or any of the you know, the permutations in between. Because in advance of an event, someone might be really experienced at doing this and they can do it with their eyes closed, and other people are doing it for the first time. But they're all part of your event, so you need to appreciate their perspective and help them where they need help. And, you know, leave them to do what they're good at where that's the case. In terms of, there's always a dance in real life events where you've got speakers turning up with a USB at the last minute. I've changed my deck. Can you plug this in? It'll only work on a Mac or only work on Windows or whatever, or it's not the right format. And there's always a push and pull between, you know, event organizers and the speakers who turn up doing that. Or they say, actually, I'm just going to wing it. I'll just go on stage and you know, we'll just take it from there. No, that's not good enough. And it's not that it's not good enough for you as an organizer. It's not good enough for your audience. You've done all the work to bring your audience to see this person on screen or on stage. And you owe it to the audience to have been strict with the speakers to make sure that they've got content that's going to work. And you know what the event's about, so you know, or you should know what's going to work for your audience. So relaying that to the speaker and the negotiation back and forward with the speaker to make sure that everything is exactly as it is. So yeah, things like, you know, how are they going to present the slides? What slides are they going to do? Do they know the platform? Are they experienced with Crowdcast? If there was an upset technically, if their broadband went down, what would they do? How could they do it? If, you know, if everything fell apart, could they come on the mobile app and give their talk there? There are all different types of scenarios that you can and should prepare for, hoping for the best, but planning for the worst, just in case. And those tech checks in advance, making sure that, and those are especially good for inexperienced speakers, because the tech check reassures them that everything will be well, will be well. All that they have to do is give the talk. The rest of the stuff will be attended to, and they don't need to fret about it. And things like helping them to look as good as possible on screen and sound as good. An awful lot of weight is given to, you know, the visuals, but no one says too much about having a decent microphone and plugging on your headphones and avoiding those echoes and so on that go on. You and I have reasonably good equipment round about us, but actually you can get as close to very, very good for a very small amount of money, and most people already have the kit that they can put their hands on to look and sound as good as they can on screen and make sure that it's not going to be too difficult, and anticipate things that might be tricky. So if you're on a single screen on a laptop and you want to share your presentation, making sure that your presentation doesn't take over the whole screen, so you then can't see the conference screen of Crowdcast and so on. So being able to work out those things in advance that your speakers might not anticipate, but you certainly can do, and helping them get the very best out of their time on screen, whether it's 5 minutes or 50 minutes, then to a large extent, they're in your hands.
Totally agree. And don't put up with speakers who say, oh, we don't need to do that. I've seen that. Someone saying, we don't need to do that. But it never bodes well. Okie dokie. Engagement. So I made this about building a community. And I guess this is about getting the results you want from having put the time in with your event. So this is about, it depends on the type of event you're running. If it's an annual conference, it's a totally different thing you're trying to achieve than if you're doing a webinar series. Do you want to start off on this and I'll jump in?
Yeah, so in its essence, every event is its own community. If you have an event with 5 people or 500 people, then because they all have that shared experience, they are a community. They might not be engaging with each other, or they might be, but they all have that in common. So in advance of the event, whoever gets to the thing at the same time on the same day, they're in that community. Now, that community might overlap with one that you already have from previous events. It might be from an organization that you're part of, where you've got members, where you've got regular attendees and so on and so on. And it might be as little as you have an email list from potential customers or existing customers and so on who you want to come to the event. They are all loosely parts of communities in their own right. But if you want to build an event that really works well, then you ideally want people to recognize that each other is part of this community and engage with each other, as well as engaging with the event. So if you can do that beforehand with, you know, teaser content in blogs and in articles and in posts and so on and social media, if you can get people talking about your event before your event happens, that's a community. And if the event goes well, then afterwards they're still talking about it. Now, they might be talking about it saying, oh, that was a terrible event, but that's still a community. That's a community of people who have a thing in common. Yeah. But again, when you think about engagement, then what you're trying to do is get the ball rolling, but you're not doing all of the pushing. So you've started it, but then other people take on some of the work because it's content that interests them, and that's what a community is.
One of the things about choosing your platform is thinking about who owns the audience. So if you're on something like Zoom or Crowdcast, you will own the audience. They've registered for your event. If you're broadcasting your morning jog on LinkedIn Live, you do not. Same with Facebook Live, is that you want it, probably you want to be able to know who it is who's engaging with your content so that you can actually start to create a database. The reason I put data protection in there is obviously we're not going to be sucking people randomly into our database. And then when you've got them, you start to build that relationship with them. And it can be outside of your content. You can communicate with them about other things you're doing. You saw us do this conference, but did you know we also do these webinars? Or you saw we did a webinar. Did you know we also write blogs? So social media is about whether you broadcast on social media, but also using social media. You said something there about creating a buzz. I was on a show earlier this week where she could not have mentioned the hashtag more if she wanted to. She was absolutely determined to have it trending, and she did. It was trending at number 5 in Ireland. She was over the moon, and she did that in a group of 80 people on a webinar. Very impressive. That was what she wanted to do, to show that there was a community there and to to engage with it. So I like that.
One thing that event organizers can forget, and I'm often as guilty as others in this, is when your event is over, you can think that your work is over, but it really isn't, because you want there to be a long tail from your event, largely because you want to organize a similar event again the next time around, and you want some follower from your previous event to benefit the next one, so you want people to come back. But when people are talking about your event afterwards, and you're sharing additional content afterwards, if there's that buzz still going on, then your event has much more impact right across the piece. It doesn't just stop as soon as you hit the end broadcast button. That's not the end of your event. That's just the beginning of the follow-up.
It might be on, we won't bother going into this one. I was going to think it's on this slide, but I was going to say, I think it might be on one of these slides about chunking up your content afterwards. So taking a big event and using clips and segments of it to promote and turning it into a podcast and things like that. We are only doing a 40-minute show today, so we're not going to go into streaming to Facebook, LinkedIn Live and Twitter. But if people want to talk about it, we can do. Content was your last of the 5, Stephen.
So the content in the show is probably the most creative side. So if you were the person on screen, we mentioned before about having a single or a multiple person on screen, and the format, what you're going to do in it. But you need to be engaging. You need to be given value. You need people to take away stuff, and it might be making an amazing talk directly to camera. It might be given a fantastic presentation with insights throughout the whole thing. It might be having a big rant on screen with a guest who's come along for an argument, as some of the shows I've done in the past, and that sort of thing people remember. So you need to plan ahead for the content. You can't just hope that it will appear on the day and you can talk off the cuff. You need to prepare in advance. If you have a guest coming on screen you're going to be interviewing, then write down your questions in advance, know them in advance, and anticipate what the answers are going to be. And I would always recommend sharing the questions, unless you really want to catch them unawares. Then sharing the questions to make sure that your guests are prepared to give not only good but interesting answers, and they're not being caught unawares. So the content, we've left it to last, but it's really vital, because a dry, dull show doesn't excite anyone, and no one's going to be speaking about it afterwards, and no one's going to be tweeting about it. So your content is vital, whether it be slides, you got mentioned there, audio, if you're playing music, if you pre-recorded content, if you were involving your audience in your show, then everything that happens from start to finish of your show is your content, and it doesn't just happen. You have to plan for it.
On the audience participation thing, you're absolutely right, is you need to let your audience know that's what you want. So you need to ahead of time say that you're available to ask questions. If you want to come on screen, you can do that. I maybe have someone in the chat whose job it is to chivvy the audience along, to get them involved. Things like the slides here as well, is making certain that you know what's going to be on those slides. I've been at an event where it wasn't me who organized the speakers, somebody else did. One of the slides was a direct pitch against the hosting organization, so you don't want to see that at the last minute. If you've got a panel of 6 people, you need to let them know how much time they're all going to have, whether you're going to introduce them, whether they're going to introduce them. Those tortuous long, can you introduce yourself, and someone's still going 7 minutes later, don't spoil the start of your event or the end of your event by that shoddy planning around you know, you want to know how it's going to feel. When Stephen and I run events, we have a graph which shows this is what's going to happen at this point in time. We're going to be in the green room, we're coming on screen, yeah. Someone's being introduced, someone's asking the questions. You know how it's going to go along, and you know who everyone's role is. You should do that for every event.
There's a well-known speaker called Tom Morley, who was he was a famous drummer in the band in the 80s, but he's on, you know, some of the Facebook forums. But he's a drummer as and percussionist as well as motivational speaker. And in advance, he makes sure that the audience all have wooden spoons or pens or pots and pans that they can tap, because he's going to ask them to participate. He's going to ask them to get involved. So, you know, that's one of the ways in which, even if he can't hear them, and if there are Zoom calls where they can be on screen, then he will hear them. But even if they're only doing it themselves, they're beating along to the thing that he's doing. And it's a great way of them feeling that they're part of the event. It's not just an inert thing where they're spectating. They're part of the thing. There's a back and forth. There's a conversation going on. So, yeah, the content, that the audience participation in that sense is a great way of making sure that people, A, they come in the first place, B, they enjoy it while they're there. They might feel a bit daft initially. And afterwards, they've experienced something that's a bit different from what they would normally expect. So you've got that, you know, before, during and after. And, you know, that's fantastic for any event.
Another really important thing to have is, we're not going to cover this one, but another really, really important thing to have is the call to action. So always think about that when you run an event. What is your end objective? And we have one here. So if you want to know more about us, there's a link down here to the Going Live website. You can look at the slides. Am I pointing the right way?
You are pointing exactly the right way.
What's the chance of that? and then you can find out about the work that Stephen and I do. So we can help you. Yeah, correct. We can help you plan your event. We can help you run your event. We can help you be on screen with you. We can be behind the scenes. And we work with companies and event organizers the world over. Stephen's worked with people in time zones I don't even know exist.
Yeah. Well, it's everything from, you know, small startup companies looking to get their name out there to big organizations and so local councils we've done events with big corporations. I do regular ones with the Miss America Foundation. I always like to mention that, of course, because everyone recognizes the name. But you would be surprised that with big and small organizations, they may not have people in-house who can organize these things. They've got a plan, they've got an idea, and they want to make an event happen. In those cases, when they want to make it happen, we help to put things in place to have a great event for them. So we're more than happy to help anyone who wants to do that.
Fabulous. Okay, cool. Well, hopefully you've enjoyed the stuff we've shared today. Feel free to get in touch. Our contact details are over there as well. Stephen and I are both very happy to have a chat with anybody. We don't always come as a pair, but we can if you want. Thank you very much for hosting this, Stephen.
Thank you very much for being hosted. And everyone who's come along, thank you. You might be watching this on Facebook or on Twitter or Twitch or any number of other platforms, but the central platform that we're on just now is Crowdcast, and Crowdcast is where you would get the best experience. So if you want to see the replay, the link will be on the show that you're seeing here, and you can come and watch this again anytime you like. So with that, thank you very much, and I hope to see you soon.
Thanks. Bye.